Welcome to NIF Conversations, where we discuss books written by fellows of the New India Foundation, books that illuminate the history, politics, society, and culture of our country in interesting and original ways. And today we are discussing this wonderful book written by Amrita Shah, who's here with me. This is a book written by someone who was trained as a journalist, so it has rich and detailed reportage. But Amrita also has a keen sense of history, of culture, of politics. And it's a quite remarkable portrait of Ahmedabad, past, present, and perhaps future. So Amrita, thanks for being with us. And I thought I'll just start a little bit on a personal note. You are obviously, from your name, Gujarati, but not from Gujarat. So which in a sense is an advantage because you're both an insider and an outsider. And how do you look at that?
Yeah, in fact, it's interesting because I have no family left in Gujarat, maybe just one uncle or so. And the first time I went to Ahmedabad that I recall was on the 25th anniversary of the Gujarat and Maharashtra formation. Okay, so was 1985, May 1st, 1985. Yeah. And I was actually traveling from Bombay to what it was then Bombay. To Ahmedabad to report on this very protracted episode of caste and communal violence. I was thrown in as a journalist into what was, clearly...
So not Gandhi's Gujarat, not what you're doing.
Exactly.
That's right. Yeah.
But it was still familiar in terms of the language, as you say. I am a Gujarati, though
so
I come from Bombay.
Yeah.
And, you know, very familiar in terms of customs and food. But it was such a rich history and politics. I just actually wasn't even aware that Ahmedabad had this kind of very complex complex history and such a progressive city in so many ways, you know, very dynamic in terms of its labor policies, which actually influenced India's labor policies, in terms of, you know, its middle class and its elite that had brought all these modernist artists from America at some point.
And architects.
Louis Kahn. And then Gandhi, all his social experiments were actually conducted in Ahmedabad, his experiments in education and...
So you went for these riots and you wrote about them?
I wrote about them.
And that began your engagement with the city?
Absolutely, yeah.
And then later, of course, you wrote... a very good book on Vikram Sarabhai.
That's
who was
right.
Part of the progressive tradition.
That's right.
So how did that happen?
So again, that was, you know, I stumbled into Ahmedabad again and again. So when I was very young, my mother had told me about Vikram Sarabhai because he died, and I remember reading it in the newspapers. I was very young then, and I happened to be in Ahmedabad many years later, and I kind of just curiously sort of said, "Oh, I'd love to read a biography of his," and I was told there wasn't one. And so it became a bit of an obsession. I started looking at books of modern India, and I'd keep looking at the index to see if he was mentioned anywhere, and he just wasn't.
Yeah.
And I found that strange. But there was another kind of thread for me, was that I had done a book earlier on television.
Uh-huh.
It was called Hype, Hypocrisy and Television in Urban India.
Uh-huh.
And anyone who looks at television history in India goes back to Sarabhai, because he was very instrumental in, you know, he wanted to bring television to India.
He started a space program.
Yes.
I mean, younger viewers should know this, because ISRO is now so big, it's an iconic public sector institution.
Yes.
But sometimes we forget the founder. And without Vikram Sarabhai, there would have been no
Absolutely.
ISRO.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And his whole idea of using technology, such a sophisticated kind of program like the space program, was for to kind of solve India's problems, India's sort of problems of literacy and health. And so communication was a big factor. So television was very kind of key. So I actually came to Sarabhai really through these two, slightly personal, and then this sort of, curiosity about someone who was so kind of, who understood the implications, social implications
of technology.
Yes.
So, I mean, before coming to your book, one last footnote on Sarabhai again.
Yeah.
For younger Indians, Sarabhai's father, Ambalal Sarabhai, supported Gandhiji's ashram.
That's
when Gandhiji admitted Dalits
and
the other funders moved out.
That's
so it's an extraordinary family.
Yes.
But to move to your the book we're discussing, which is the product of a New India Foundation Fellowship, you know, you wrote a biography of a great resident of Ahmedabad.
Mm-hmm.
Vikram Sarabhai.
Yes.
And now you're writing a biography of a city.
Right.
Now, reading your book, and of course visiting Ahmedabad, a remark of the great Kannada writer U.R. Anantamurthy comes to mind. Anantamurthy said, India lives simultaneously in the 12th century and the 20th century.
Right.
And all centuries in between.
Right.
And I mean, Ahmedabad is the city of Vikram Sarabhai in our space program,
yes,
but also such a deep ancient history. And you know, this collision of centuries, which comes out in your book,
yeah,
I think is part of what makes it fascinating.
It is, definitely. And if you just look at the architecture, it has every period of architecture. You know, it's pre-Mughal, the Sultanate architecture,
yeah,
Mughal architecture, it's British colonial architecture, it has modern, it has the modernist Corbusier Khan, and it has, you know, and then Kanwinder Rai and various extremely Doshi.
Right, right.
And then you come to the kind of more, democratic, let's say, architecture that you see now, which is, so Ahmedabad has every period, virtually, yeah, depending on where you go.
So, about the architecture, you're absolutely right. It has a dazzling range of, you know, varieties of architecture spanning different styles, different religious traditions, different centuries. But, you know, reading your book and speaking about architecture, I was reminded of a remark of Aldous Huxley, who, when he saw the Taj Mahal, said, "Marble conceals a multitude of sins." Okay, now, so Ahmedabad is a city of fabulous architecture. It's a city of the great Gandhi, but it's also a city of conflict and violence and savagery, which you're, you know, how do you,
absolutely,
and your book talks about that. Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah.
I've been trying for years to understand this, and 85, my trip even then at that very early stage was trying to understand. This question is always asked, there's such violence in Gandhi's Gujarat. It's,
yeah,
continually. And
yeah,
Ahmedabad is the epicenter. You had the very first post-independence massive riot in 1969. I'd say violence, because riot I find is not an adequate way to describe,
yeah, yeah,
what happens. So I don't think I have the answer.
Yeah.
But perhaps one possibility is that the dynamism which allows it to move, in a sense, almost without emotion. So, you know, when the mills, for instance, the large mills closed down, people,
yeah,
are very worried, because almost...
This was in the 80s and 90s?
The 70s it starts. I mean, 60s, 70s, and then, yes.
Again, if
you
look at it historically, Ahmedabad was called the Manchester of India.
Absolutely.
So it was really, and all the money of the Sarabhais,
yes,
and the, came from that.
Yeah.
So then in the 80s, you had this decline.
You started having the decline already by the 70s because,
okay,
of power looms, etc.
Yeah.
So, and 1/4 of the city, they say, was involved in the mills in some way. The city was shaped around in many ways. You know, the night market, all of that was so the workers could come anytime and eat and...
Right.
Various. Huh. They say women's safety. It's because,
yeah,
of that.
It used to be fantastic. I know, women's safety, unbelievable.
Yeah.
2 a.m. you could walk, women could
because
walk out.
Because there were always workers going and from, to and,
yeah,
from the mills,
yeah,
at all times in the, you know, so,
yeah,
3-4 shifts.
Huh.
So it was a city, as I said, very, very closely kind of connected with the mills. And the,
yeah,
mills shut down.
Yeah.
And you would think that this city then will, and it did go into a kind of, let's say, a depression of sorts.
Yeah.
But it rose up again. And the reason is that it's very entrepreneurial. So,
yeah,
people found work somehow or the other. I'm not saying it was a happy time.
Yeah.
But it did not collapse. It did not die. And that's why it's a 600-year-old city that still...
So even though the mills declined, something else took its place. So it did not...
Yes.
The kind of energy, the vigor, the entrepreneurship...
Yes.
Kept on going.
Yes.
Now, recently, Ahmedabad has been declared, I think, India's first... World,
right,
Heritage City.
Right.
Is that correct?
Well, the old city has been. Old city
old
of Ahmedabad,
city.
Yes.
Okay, okay.
Yeah.
And what are your thoughts on that? Does it deserve it? Doesn't Delhi deserve it more? let's have some fun.
You know, yeah. They say actually Delhi is the oldest and Ahmedabad is the second oldest surviving city. You know,
yeah,
in that sort of...
yeah.
You know, of course, I love Delhi, but,
yeah,
I'm partial to Ahmedabad. So,
okay,
I would say it certainly deserves it, because I don't think people are quite aware of the sort of variety and the kind of multiplicity, the layers. And they've really done a good job of trying to kind of now, because there was a time when they were actually selling off, you know, stripping doors, old houses, and selling off, you know, things in the market and the antiques market.
Yeah.
But now I think that's
and
been
stop.
Arrested.
Okay.
And but what does bother me very, very much about the heritage business? I mean, I think,
yeah,
heritage has a lot of politics, you know, that sort,
yeah,
of underlies it. And what is important is, so what are you preserving? Which heritage?
Right.
And that is a question that I would ask certainly about Ahmedabad, because,
yeah, yeah,
there are many parts and many stories, and which one is being kind of built up more? And one thing that does concern me, so let's say there's this one question, for instance, the naming of the city.
Yeah, yeah.
Nobody disputes that it was founded by Ahmed Shah in 1411.
Yeah. Yeah.
But now there's been for a while this controversy about...
Call it Karnavati.
Karnavati.
But I think that will go now with this heritage tag. I hope so.
I don't know. But the thing I would say is that if you have to, because I don't... What they say, what historians say is Karnavati might have been an outpost.
Okay.
Or might have been a town. But
right.
But the greater claim is for a tribal settlement of Ashavali.
Okay,
you see,
okay.
So if you have to, then you have to look at all these and how far back and,
you know.
But you have to admit what is known. So you can't say that Ahmad Shah did not found the city. That's one. The other thing that is kind of a very recent thread. You know, there was this old story about Bengali boys being brought in from Bengal to teach Gujaratis to throw bombs during the very early phase, in the early 1900s.
Yeah.
Now that has been kind of, and I think it's a very interesting part of Ahmedabad's history.
Yeah.
But that has been played up now so much that you almost start, if you're a visitor and going on the heritage walks, you almost start seeing there's a violent history, much more than what you hear.
I think this also maybe partly, you know, there's, you don't want to give Gandhi all the credit.
That's
so you want to see the freedom movement before Gandhi.
There's
a larger logic to all of this. Yeah.
I think it's good that more histories and more stories are coming up.
Yeah.
But I think that if we can keep the whole range of it, then that's important. That's important to protect.
Yeah. Now, so, you know, your book is, I mean, it's a great portrait of a city. And I think we, of course, at the foundation are delighted to have published it. I think with Ahmedabad getting a heritage tag, it'll have a rich life. Your book, every tourist should have it. To know that it's not just pretty buildings, it's people struggling, thriving, working, fighting, you know, sometimes happy, sometimes sad. It's a history of beauty, but also sometimes barbarism and savage violence. So in that sense, it's, you know, it's all about human life. But as we conclude, just tell us briefly about your new project, which is again quite different.
Right.
Yeah.
So, you know, I had a great-grandfather who went to South Africa in the early 1900s.
Who was Gujarati, like
Gujarati.
You.
I didn't know, I mean, I'm saying now early 1900s, at that point I didn't really know exactly when. And he married my great-grandmother along on this journey. And she died soon after giving birth to my grandmother. So the thing is, we know nothing about why he went to South Africa. But it was a time of Gandhi. And we don't know who she was, my great-grandmother. So I just started on this search to try and find what I could. And so I went to South Africa, ended up in the archives there. And what I found was a really rich... I found a lot of details about his journey and what he was doing. And I think it sheds a kind of light on the Gandhi era that we are not familiar with at all. Because it's looking at it from the point of view not of not just the struggle, but also of the people who went there to trade and do business. Following the indentured workers. So these were Gujaratis, as you yourself have
passenger
written
Indians.
The passenger Indians.
That's right.
The people who paid their own
fare. I think, you know, it's because, again, you know, for younger readers, I mean, your book will be important because Indians of today, you know, Indians who are in their 20s and 30s, think of the Indian diaspora as software engineers and doctors in England and America and Canada, right? And occasionally businessmen and entrepreneurs. But of course, the Indian diaspora has a much longer history and often a subaltern history.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's not just Europe, but it's Africa, it's the Caribbean. I'm sure it'll be a great story, as is this book. And thanks so much for being with us. And we're delighted to have published it, and it's great that Ahmedabad is a heritage city, so it means your book also has a fresh and new life. And thanks so much, Amit.
Thank you, Ram.